All right, this is John Colo with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. Today I'm here in Las Vegas, Nevada, and I'm going to show you guys the Las Vegas worm farm. And actually, it's not some huge facility. You know, I've been to like the Arizona worm farm, linked down below that video. I've been to worm farms in Texas and California, links down below to those videos. I love visiting worm farms because for you guys that are gardeners, right, worms and worm castings are one of my essential go-tos for all organic gardeners, right? If you're gardening here in Vegas, you definitely want to know about Las Vegas Worm Farm because they will supply you the best worm castings, and I guarantee that, in Las Vegas, and we're going to prove it in a little bit, but also offer you guys the worms to start your own worm bin or to actually put the worms like I do directly in my garden to benefit my garden and break down organic matter and then turn that into food and biology, more importantly, for your vegetables. If you guys don't live in Las Vegas, this video is gonna be very valuable because you can see literally how you can start your own worm farm in your garage. That's what Las Vegas Worm Farm is doing. They've created different like a trommel, like from scratch using a treadmill, which is really cool. They have different kinds of equipment they've bought and experimented with over the years to dial in their specific systems for making the best worm castings, but also, of course, breeding worms so they could continue to expand their worm farm. Now, one of the big goals of Las Vegas Worm Farm is to use only locally sourced ingredients, and in most cases they're diverting waste products that would normally go to the landfill. There's no municipal composting here in Las Vegas, unfortunately, so they get food scraps in these little 5 gallon buckets that then they will grind up through an imported hammer mill to grind up into like literally a mush so they could feed that to their worms. They also use leaves, which this is the coolest thing I've ever seen done with leaves. You guys are going to want to see this in the video. They literally use a hammer mill to turn leaves into leaf dust. Yes, it's like sawdust, but it's leaf dust. Totally amazing. They take the cardboard, they run it through the hammer mill to make like a nice fluffy cardboard to provide the perfect bedding for their worms as well. So they're really doing some cool stuff here, and they've got their systems dialed in, and that's what I want to take you guys on the journey of how Las Vegas Worm Farm started, how they got interested in growing the worms here in Las Vegas, in the desert. Yes, worms live in the desert. Yes, outside and in. We'll show you guys that. And so let's go ahead and start off on the journey with their very first worm bin. So this is where the journey started for the Las Vegas Worm Farm. Literally one worm factory right here, right? They got it so that they could reduce their family's food waste. And instead of sending things to the landfill, because food waste here just goes in the garbage can, then it goes to the landfill and it just rots and it does nothing for nobody. they got a worm factory, which all you guys could get at home. And you can see inside here, they got basically the bedding and they feed the food scraps and the compost to the worms inside here. And we can pick this up and you guys can see there's lots of worms growing inside here. And now this was the first bin that they still maintain to this day, just kind of as a hobby, because it's like they've been doing it and they know it works. And this really spurred them on to get growing worms in other places. So to be honest, what happened was when they got the worm factory, they kept it in the garage like most well-meaning people would do, right? But the issue is in the garage in the summertime in Las Vegas, it's like 100 degrees. The worms, unfortunately, literally fried, because here on the front of the thing, it says ideal temperature for worms is between 40 degrees and 80. They don't like it freezing, and they don't like it too hot either. And in the garage in Vegas, right, when you're not managing it properly, it's going to get too hot, and they all lost their lives. So because that happened, then he's like, hey, I kept worms successfully for a little bit of time in a bin, but it got too hot. And then they croaked because the garage got way too hot. So then he's like, hey, let's move outside and experiment outside and let's try to keep worms in nature, which is where worms would naturally live, outside in the soil. So let's check out their outdoor bin, their second bin that they started and have had huge success growing worms with in Las Vegas.
All right, so now we're outside and you can see this is their second bin that they ever created. They made it a lot larger and it's just out of this really inexpensive fiberboard material, which I actually recommend you guys not use. I do recommend at least minimally to use plywood, but better would be actually to use real wood. You know, this is held together with glues and whatnot, and it's gonna degrade worse in the weather. Luckily, it doesn't rain too much here in Las Vegas because the water will really do a lot of damage to this stuff. That being said, it's been holding together pretty good. I see a little bit of rot near the bottom where it probably gets pretty wet, but I'm amazed at how well actually even this really inexpensive box, like it's closed on the bottom, is surviving the weather here. So normally he leaves the top off. Let's just go ahead and pull the top off so you guys can see what it looks like. And inside this literally bed here, he has it lined with plastic on part of it. Maybe the whole thing was lined at one point. Maybe just the side with the against the house is lined. And you can see he basically puts in specialized bedding material that he gets. He gets compost from a local compost facility here for landscapers that is unfortunately not open to the public, which is actually decent compost from what I'm seeing. And he basically mixes in food scraps from his home. So if I, you know, we can see some lettuce here that he buried. He just basically buried whole little, you know, stems of lettuce. I see some bell peppers in here. Here's a bell pepper in here. He just buries the whole bell pepper, you know. So he uses a little bit different technique, you know, for having the worms outside than the stuff that he actually will sell you. This is mostly just for hobby and for personal use. So on rare occasions, he'll actually harvest the castings in here and just spread it out on his garden and or his lawn in the backyard. But I mean, and then he says like, you know, maybe you got to water it a couple times a week, except in the summer when you got to water it every single day. The water will help keep it a little bit cooler so that the worms can survive. You know, despite the air temperature being really warm, right, there's a lot of thermal mass, and especially if you water this, Dan, it's going to keep things a little bit cooler, so you can keep worms alive outside. That being said, you know, I prefer to have worms in my raised garden beds. That way my automatic irrigation system comes on daily to water my plants, and of course it's also watering, you know, the soil and keeping it moist for the worms that are living in my soil as well. So another setup he has outside is this guy right here. So I'm gonna show you guys what this looks like. So this is another system he has. Once again, he's just using pretty inexpensive lumber. And on this, he has lids that stay on the top, because on this one, he like will literally put in, you know, just like old pieces of bread, big leaves. Oh, here's a tortilla shell that just didn't get eaten or didn't get used. Or whatever, he's got cake in here. So he basically covers it. Otherwise, if you don't cover it, you may have rodent problems, right? He did have some problems with mice, but then in that bed he buries everything, so pretty much they're not going to get it. But in this, he just puts stuff on top, and there's tons of worms growing, and that's why he covers this one. This was kind of an experiment to find out if this actually system would work, because this is called more of like a flow-through system, because he puts stuff on the top, it works its way down, and then I want to show you guys what it looks like on the bottom. You know, as he puts food scraps on top, the worms will come up to the top to eat, and over time the food scraps will work their way down as he keeps, you know, putting new stuff on the top, and all the castings will basically end up coming out the bottom.
All right, so I'm going to show you guys what it looks like on the bottom here, going to the bottom underneath. And if we point the camera up, you guys can see underneath, I mean, all there simply is, there's just PVC tubes, right, just going across. And what'll happen is all the compost will just kind of drop through the areas when it's ready to drop down and just fall down below, where then he will harvest it. So this is a very simple system you guys can implement at home to create your own worm castings and, you know, stop throwing away your food waste.
So after he made these two systems, he's like, wow, growing worms is kind of fun. And then his kind of, you know, hobby kind of like took over, right? And then he's like, hey, let's start a worm business and grow worms on a bigger scale. And to do that, right, he started doing it inside where he can better control the temperature, the feedstock,
and all the different elements, the moisture level, the humidity of the worms. So let's go ahead and head back into the garage and show you guys how he's growing like lots of worms and making castings in his garage. All right, so you guys can see this is how he's growing worms in his garage. He's basically got these steel shelving units that then he uses some wood. And this is just like kind of like a melamine wood. Once again, this is like particle board. This is not the wood I would use, but this is what he is using. I know it's really inexpensive material to kind of get up and get started. And it's holding pretty good. I mean, I'm amazed it's not really rotting out. Maybe it's like kind of like growing and expanding in width, but I'm impressed it's working. And actually the worms don't seem to complain too much. And he has these long beds built into these shelving units, which is all steel. And very important, he has a thermometer. And right now it's 80 degrees inside the beds, which is actually a really nice temperature, perfect for the worms. I mean, the outside temperature today is like mid-60s, and we have been in the 50s. But basically, you got to think of this as nice and insulated. He also has a sprinkler system built in to his whole setup that waters his worms with a humic acid filtered water mixture to keep them hydrated. And then all he simply does is he basically, every 2 days, he'll load this up with food. So every 2 days, he'll put about 10 pounds of the feed that I'll show you guys how he makes in a minute. He puts it on top, and the worms come up to eat. And there's about 10 pounds of worms in this whole bed here. And every 2 days, he feeds 10 pounds. So the worms literally eat half their weight, or, you know, 5 pounds of food scraps in a day. He feeds every other day, so he's feeding 10 pounds every other day, and they eat 5 pounds a day because they're 10 pounds total. And then this whole bed, as he's loading up the top, right, this whole bed to go through will take about 6 months to mature fully for the first time. Once it goes the whole 6 months, then he can harvest off the bottom, which I'll show you guys. It's kind of like similar to the one with the PVC pipes outside, a little bit more refined. And then once it's 6 months, then he'll do the first harvest. And then thereafter, right, it takes 3 months from his feedstock that he puts on the top, his food waste and compost that he's feeding the worms, for it to work down as he's piling new stuff on top. It keeps working its way down. And then finally, after 3 months, the stuff on the bottom is then also ready to be harvested. The cool thing about this worm farm, unlike other worm farms I've visited, other worm farms will just randomly just harvest their product and have it ready to go and bag for you. They don't do that at Las Vegas Worm Farm. This is what makes their castings truly superior, a much more fully alive product than what I've seen at other worm farms. Because literally when you order it one day, he'll then come out here and then harvest it, right? And then deliver it to you, right? The next day. So he's like, you call me, I need castings today. You can't get it. You got to wait for tomorrow because he hasn't even harvested stuff he's going to sell you tomorrow. Because he's going to harvest it when you order it, right? So that's really cool that he's doing that. And we're going to show you why this makes a difference when we check out his microscope setup in a little bit. So yeah, that's the setup. And he's got currently 6 of these bins. This is the oldest one. He started the one below it, and then he has a rack of 3, and then a rack of one more on the other side. So yeah, this is the way he produces the castings to sell you guys. And let me go ahead and show you guys real quick how he harvests. All right guys, we're gonna show you guys how he harvests his castings. And literally the first thing he does, he takes these little totes and he puts it underneath. And then what happens is, if you guys could see up in there, there's basically a grate, and there's it's gonna almost fall through, but it's not falling through yet. So then he has this tool here, right, that he'll shove in, that he's left a little gap right here. He'll shove this tool in, and as you guys can see, I'm just shoving it in, right, and he will just saw it, and you'll see the casting just start to literally fall down, or you've seen a little bit of castings fall right as I'm doing that, right? So I mean, he just goes in and he just basically shaves off a little bit of the bottom, or rakes it off, literally, to have, you know, the fresh castings. There's the castings I harvested just a little bit in the corner. Don't want to mess up his setup here. But yeah, he'll harvest the bottom off. So yeah, there's some of the castings I just harvested off the bottom.
that has been through the system, took 6 months to get it. And then once he has this, then he'll put it through his trommel to sift it off into a nice fine mixture, so you're not getting large particles. You're getting like worm castings and bedding that has gone through his system.
So you guys saw how he makes the casting, and literally at this point he has all his beds working. So it takes 3 months to basically go through the process to make the casting. So this is like a fine aged wine. You know, most compost that's made in like a big compost facility could take, you know, 30 or even as short as 90 days, which is making a very high bacterial content compost, which in most cases are not good for your vegetable garden, because your vegetable garden has too much bacterial content and needs more fungal activity. That being said, another thing he's producing here for sale are the live worms. So in these bins, this is where he grows the worms that he will sell you, right? He does not grow the worms he's selling you in those beds. Those beds are specifically designed to make the castings. In these little bins here, each one of these bins has about 3 pounds of live worms. So if he got an order for worms, he'd go over to this bed and look at this. This is insane. Look at all these worms in just this little handful there. There's tons of worms. I feel them moving around, right? So, you know, a lot of worm farms may sell you the worms out of their bins, which they're not this dense, right? So yeah, these are the ones he sells, and he doesn't have like tons of worms. His facility is not that big, but he does have about 3 pounds of worms in each of these bins. So that means at present time, he has about 12 pounds of worms on hand that he could sell you if you wanted to add worms to make your own compost bin, whether it's a worm factory, whether it's something outside, or whether you could just buy the worms and just stick them into your garden time. I would recommend waiting until the springtime after the first frost to put them in your garden so they could live the entire summer, provided you're watering and adding nice organic compost and maybe some mulch on the top. They'll eat all that and then basically put their castings where you need them. Now, the other process he's doing besides creating the castings and creating the worms to sell you, he's doing breeding, making breeding worms for his own personal use on site. And that's very interesting how he does that. I just want to show you guys this for those of you guys that are interested in worms, because he does it a little bit differently than how he's making the worms that he's selling or the castings. All right, so to make the breeding worms, he actually has like a grow tent here in the garage. We're gonna go ahead and open it up and head inside and show you guys the difference and why he's doing the breeding worms inside the tent. All right, let's head into the grow tent. So inside the grow tent, you got a couple things. You got a swamp cooler for the summer. You have also a humidifier, very important for all times of the year. Since we live in an arid climate, it's quite dry. And he also better regulates the temperature in here and keeps it nice and warm, probably around like 80 degrees. So it's like 80 degrees and humid inside here. And let's go ahead and step in. So inside here, it's nice, warm, and humid. And why does he do that? Because, you know, while worms may be reproducing in some of his production beds where he makes the castings, or even where he has the worms that are available for sale for you guys, right? Those are not the perfect ideal situations for the worms to breed, right? The worms will breed in, guess what? The springtime, when the nature's getting nice, when they're gonna have a nice long summer. They don't wanna breed in the middle of winter time when it's really cold out, because then their young would not make it, right? So he wants to provide ideal, quote, spring-like conditions for his worms, including the perfect temperature, the perfect humidity, right? And more importantly, he feeds them a different diet than what he's feeding his worms that he's making for to sale or to make the casting. So he has a special mixture. And this, guess what? It's a high protein mixture. I'll show you guys how he makes this from literally local ingredients here. It's really cool. Once again, diverting landfill waste, high protein mix. This is what he feeds to his worms along with some of the food scraps. So high protein mix, very important. And then he has all these bins labeled, you know, and he basically will grow the worms in there. So yeah, this is the perfect mixture, perfect temperature, perfect humidity to allow the worms to basically get busy and breed. Now, unlike humans, where we will just keep breeding even if we're like, you know, overcrowded, right? The worms, they will breed if there's enough space, right? If they know that, hey, our worm bin that we live in is this big and we already have this many worms, right? There's 10 pounds in here. We're not going to make more, because if we made more worms, some of us are going to lose our lives because this environment cannot support us all. Meanwhile, humans keep breeding and breeding. That's a whole nother topic. So, you know, that's why he has different bins, so that he will basically allow them enough space, give them enough nutrition so that they'll basically max out the bin and make lots of new baby worms, that then he'll basically rotate these worms, these baby worms, into his system so that he could then create more bins to create compost and, of course, the worms that he's going to end up selling you. All right, so you saw how he grows the worms, but what you didn't see is how he processes the castings after they're harvested, or what exactly he is feeding his worms. And that's what I want to show with you guys right now, including the feed that he's feeding his worms. Number one, the feed he's actually producing on site to feed his breeding worms. Also, some of the equipment he uses to process the castings, and more importantly, some of the techniques he uses to ensure he's going to have, you know, high bacterial and fungal counts without killing some of the biologics that he works so very hard to get. So I think first we will start with feeding. What does he feed his worms? Well, number one thing he feeds his worms, he diverts food scraps that would normally go to the landfill. He gets it collected in these 5-gallon buckets, and I have plenty of these buckets at home with food scraps myself. He'll get the food scraps and then he'll pulp the food scraps, very important. He's creating more BSA, bacterial surface area, by basically grinding up the food scraps into like a nice fine, literally mush, you know. And I'll show you the equipment that he uses to do this, because he's gone through his gamut of buying the wrong equipment, wasting money. So I don't want that to happen to you if you guys want to get equipment to grind your own, you know, food scraps for your worms. That being said, in his inside garage production, he grinds all the food, because then it just degrades quicker, the worms eat it more. And as you saw in his outside bins, he just puts in the food whole, because he's not worried about production. That's just a home hobby thing. And yeah, you could feed worms whole foods, uncut up, you know, cucumbers and peppers and stuff. But if you grind it up, it's just going to work that much better and, of course, that much faster. All right, so creating a perfect particle size for the food waste as well as his other inputs to feed his worms, he takes very seriously, because he knows that this could cause your ultimate success or ultimate failure, you know, when feeding your worms. And once again, he's been dialing in his process for several years now. So he originally started with this thing, which is a Sky Food. This is actually a commercial blender, and it basically just a big blender. So it has a blade at the bottom, you put the food in, you turn it on, and then you just basically tip it over to get everything out. You know, he found this did not work that well. It ground up things maybe too finely. Some of the things in the top, if you don't have enough liquid in there, it's not going to go down and grind, especially due to the shape of this container. It's like a funnel, which, you know, this is good for liquids, but not processing solid mass. You know, he was able to get this locally, and unfortunately, I believe this machine, which I now want one because it is badass, I want one. He had to unfortunately import, because they're not readily available in the U.S. from what he's telling me. So I'm going to have to look this up further. This is known as a hammer mill. This thing is badass. It's just called the hammer mill, made in China. Had to import this from China, bought it on some website, and they had to pay import duties and all these crazy things. And it's the CF158. And he loves this thing, man. I love this thing too. What you do is you basically put the food waste, or he puts other things in the grinder here, and then it basically grinds it up with a hammer mill. And then you could put in different size screens into this hammer mill, so then as the material comes out, you could run it through a finer screen, which means everything is going to be grinded up to a smaller particle size, or even like a larger screen, just to pulp things up, right? So he'll put the food scraps in here, and it makes a nice, really nice texture, you know, not getting it too liquid, grinding up to nice particulate size for his worms, so his worms can enjoy it. Now, the other thing he does besides putting food scraps through here is he'll put cardboard through here. So I'm going to show you guys the results of putting cardboard through the hammer mill. So he puts the whole cardboard through the hammer mill. He always makes sure this is not glossy when he puts it through. And then basically he gets this stuff. This kind of looks like a litter you would find in like a rat cage or something like that. It's really nice and fluffy, man. It's not super broken down, But what this will do is this will help with aeration because it's just really fluffy, man. It's kind of broken down, but it's not really fine shreds. It's really trippy, man. I love how fluffy this is. This is like a little ball. Look at that. It goes in and out. And it is broken down, but it's not. So, yeah, really cool texture on the hammer mill with the cardboard. That being said, you know, while this is cool, could be beneficial. You know, I kind of like using a paper shredder, a high-end paper shredder that really grinds up to a smaller particle size. But once again, this is pretty cool, a little bit different than my paper shredder. But of course, this is a lot faster. But of course, this is also a heck of a lot louder too. Now, the last thing I'm going to show you guys he does with the hammer mill is completely ingenious. And this blew my mind. All right, guys, so check this out. This totally blew my mind. You guys see three bins here, and I'll explain to you guys what are in these bins. But this is what totally tripped me out. I was like, wow, I need one of these. This is the baddest ass thing I've seen in a long time. Put a big smile on my face. Made me really happy. This center bin right here, if you guys look at it, what does it look like? I could pick this stuff up. Look at this. It literally looks like sawdust, right? But this is not sawdust. This is all locally sourced leaves he got from the neighborhoods, from his neighbors, all this stuff. He put the leaves, wow, kind of smells like leaves too. He put the leaves through the hammer mill with the fine screen on it, and it literally made leaf dust. This stuff is insane. You know how amazing leaf dust is? I mean, I'm excited because I know the possibilities now of the leaves turning into leaf dust now, creating a lot more bacterial surface area. You put leaves in to feed your worms, the worms are gonna take a while to break down the cellular structure of the leaves. But you put in leaf dust, right? It gets eaten so much faster because it's already at a size the worms can eat. It's like if you feed baby food, mushed up puree, or feed them a whole apple, right? Yeah, babies could choke on whole apples, not gonna be able to chew it up. They don't even got teeth. So like this is the perfect food for the worms. As a matter of fact, all these items he will feed to his breeders only because it is so valuable and in limited quantities. Of course, if he had unlimited resources and had leaves to get all year round and all this stuff and had lots of leaves, he would start mixing some of this into his regular worm bins. But because the leaves are very valuable, he doesn't have a lot, he will only feed this to his breeders. So hopefully, you know, worm farms will learn about how you could literally grind up leaves into leaf dust and feed it. You know, before he started making the leaf dust, what he did was he would buy the chicken crumbles, which is like, you know, food for the chickens, and then he would grind that up. The problem with the chicken crumbles and feeding worms, which many worm farms do, is that he found the chicken crumbles would actually kill his worms and reduce the biology because it was either too much protein or maybe some contaminants in there or something going on. So he doesn't really use the chicken powdered chicken crumbles anymore. While he does use a leaf, dust sometimes. Instead, what he's been using is this. This is a mixture of leaf dust and mesquite pods. So mesquite pods are a food that Native Americans ate. Actually, I had some mesquite powder the other day because I eat that regularly in my diet. With the hammer mill, you can basically find mesquite pods, grind them up to a fine particle size, and then we could actually eat it. That being said, he's basically getting the mesquite pods as well as leaves, grinding it up, and some of the seeds of the mesquite is still too hard to even go through the hammer mill, but the pods are totally ground up, and that's what this mixture is here. This is a mixture of the leaves and the mesquite pods. I mean, I'm a tool freak, and really the hammer mill, dude, it's the bomb. I gotta get one after visiting this farm, and if you're hardcore about your worms, or even just breaking down material so they're composting faster, the hammer mill is the way to go, and I'm about to find me a good one to buy, and when I do, I'll probably have a video on it. But yeah, this leaf dust, tripping me out, man. And also think about the space savings, man. This was a lot of leaves. He's like, this was like four big bins of leaves turned into one small bin of leaf dust. Most amazing thing I've seen in a long time. All right, so far you learned about the food scraps he grinds up to feed to his worms in the hammer mill. You also learned about the leaf powders and mesquite meal powders he makes with the hammer mill to feed his breeders, but he could also feed his worms if he had a lot more quantity of those. Now the main thing he feeds his worms is the compost, right? Most worm farms I visit don't feed just straight food scraps to their worms. The worms take a lot longer to break that stuff down. So what he does is he gets locally made compost for mostly landscape waste with smaller amounts of food waste in it from a composting facility called Terra Firma that I need to visit. Unfortunately, they don't sell compost to the public from what I've been told. They only sell to businesses. That being said, what you're seeing here is not Terra Firma compost. It's basically improved Terra Firma compost. So he gets a Terra Firma compost. He further will sift it out and sift out the large, big pieces of wood at present time, although he may be keeping those in the future based on his soil microbiology testing he's been doing. And then he'll inoculate it with compost tea to basically enliven it to make it even better. And I'll say that, you know, this compost that he has here that he's basically taking the Terra Firma, sifted out more, and then spraying down with the compost tea every regularly. Man, look at this stuff. This is some really nice soil, guys. Some of the nicest soil I've seen in Vegas. Now, yes, there's a lot of more fibers in there than maybe what I'd like, you know, but mixing this in with other bag soils and native soil to grow in a vegetable garden would be the bomb. That being said, he doesn't sell this stuff because this is the stuff that's valuable to him, because it'll take basically four parts of this compost mixture, one part of the food scraps, and this actually has a really, really amazing, nice, earthy smell, man. Serious. Four parts of this, one part of the food scraps, he'll mix it up into a slurry, and then that's what he feeds on all his boxes, those white boxes, where he basically has the worms to break down the food scraps and the compost to make the castings that he ends up selling you. So basically what he's creating is a value-added product. He's taking local landscape waste that's been composted, further processing it, making it better, taking food scraps, adding this to this, so once again, all these things would normally go to the landfill, diverting it, and then turning it into some of the highest quality worm castings that money could buy here in Vegas. Now, the cool thing about Las Vegas worm farm is that they do not ship, right? He wants everything to be created here, right? With waste and products he could source locally, and then he wants to sell it here also, which I highly respect that a lot. You know, I'm like, hey man, you could make your castings better by going to LA and picking up a whole bunch of free insect frass from Compton like I do. Link down below to that video. But he's like, I don't want to do that, man. I'm not bringing in something from LA to like add to my castings and make it better. I'm like, well, then if you want to make your castings better, the only way to do that is then start having your own black soldier flies or your own mealworms, feeding them, right? Locally produced scrap materials, and then harvesting their castings, and then feeding that to your worm. So like, there's always a way to make your quality better if you don't want to bring things in from far away, which I highly respect. Although for me, I'm super lazy. I would not want to implement growing mealworms or or black soldier flies just so I could feed the castings to my worms. But you know, farms like Arizona Worm Farm, link down below to their video, that's what they do. They have their own black soldier flies so they could feed castings of the black soldier flies to their worms to make their worm castings even better. So yeah, my hat's off to them, but yeah, if you have a local place that makes mealworms or even just buying black soldier fly frass, you know, in bulk from a manufacturer and then adding that to your feedstock, that would up the level for sure of the biology and the quality of your worm castings for gardeners. All right, so once he harvests the castings, and I showed you guys how he harvests the castings, so basically he used to put the castings through this setup here. This setup is normally designed to basically sift out seeds or maybe grains or something like that. Also could work for castings. This thing is actually quite small, but when he only had a few bins, it totally worked great. I think these things run over $1,000, maybe $1,200. They're stainless steel. He did make one mistake. He got one with a single screen, and he should have got one with dual screens. So he actually added in the second screen level in here. And this thing will just vibrate and shake, and he'll put the castings in here. It'll come down, and then he'll collect the castings that come out here that have been sieved through, and those are the ones he sells. The stuff that comes through here, then he'll refeed and work back into his system. Now, this worked great when he was really small, but he's gotten a lot bigger, so he's outgrown this little shaker setup. The other thing he said about the shaker setup is it works really well for dry ingredients, but his castings are quite moist because the moisture level is critical to have healthy worms. If you have it too dry or too wet, they don't like it, and they just like that sweet spot You know, so it's the right moisture content, and the casting that he produces are a little bit too moist to go through this setup. So then what I respect about this worm farmer is that he created his own trommel system that would have costed like thousands of dollars for literally, you know, I don't think of me spent like around under 500 bucks to make this setup I'm gonna show you guys right now. All right guys, this is one badass trommel setup that he basically made homemade himself, put it all together, and it totally works. He cranks it up to maximum like 3 miles per hour, and it's already cranking so fast he could crank it up to 10 miles, but then it might just start rolling down the street. Anyways, what he did was he just got some 2x4s, so the whole base is made out of 2x4s that he screwed together. He then got some bicycle tires, so he has three of them, one on each side. He basically used tie wraps to tie wrap this screen material, mesh fabric material too, that's used for like, you know, fences and whatnot. He has two different sizes, so he has a smaller size over on this side and a larger size over on this side. And so he could feed in, depending on what he's sifting, he could feed from that side first to, you know, get out all the small stuff, or he could, you know, sift from this side down, and he'll raise up the side that he wants it to go to, so he can screen out the big stuff first. So depending on if he's doing, like, you know, the bedding worms, or doing, you know, his casting material, or whether he's doing the, you know, fresh, you know, locally made compost to screen out the larger material, will depend on which way he runs this setup. The other thing, he basically put like plastic, looks like almost like garbage bag material underneath the catch, anything that falls through the screens. He has a little belt here, which is a standard industrial belt. And this is the cool part of the setup. We're gonna move for you so you guys can see it. You're thinking, what the heck is that, John? Well, yeah, so he went out and bought like a treadmill for some guy for like under $100. And the guy's like, I don't know if it works. So he plugged it in. Sure enough, it worked. And basically he took apart the treadmill, took out the motor of the treadmill, which is right here. And then he connected that to the belt drive to like basically the bicycle tire. So that's how this spins around when this comes on. He has the basically the power supply of the treadmill right here in like a little box so nobody gets shocked. And then he kept the whole like control panel of the treadmill right here, and to turn it on, he has like the little safety switch he has to like put in place so we can start it and stop it. And of course, if you want to just stop it real quick, he just pulls this out and it'll stop it from running. So man, this thing's badass. And actually, I need one of these myself. I wouldn't use it that much, but when I did use it, man, it'd be so valuable. I love it that he made this thing himself. I mean, it's like the first homemade, like literally low-cost trommel I've seen that looks like totally solid. All right, so before we head inside and show you guys his microscope setup and show you guys a live sample of what his worm castings look like on the microscope, I want to share this with you guys because, you know, this farmer takes every possible effort to maximize the health of his worms, but more importantly, the health of the biology that he's sending you. He has done testing where he's tested compost piles and even compost from local sources, and honestly, guys, they don't fare well. And of course, this does not surprise me because we are in the desert. There's not really many composting facilities, and unfortunately, most people that compost maybe don't compost the right methods to yield the best compost for gardening, right? Maybe it's good for like landscape grasses and whatnot, but not for gardening where we need more fungal content, right? So that's what he's doing here. He basically takes the city water that then he will then put through a filter to take out the chlorine and some of the other contaminants. It'll go into this tote here that then he will also add humic substances to ensure that everything is gotten out of the water. He also lets it basically sit to aerate out. And then he'll use this, you know, to water the worms as needed manually. But more importantly, this is the water he uses for his setup, his irrigation setup that basically keeps all the worm beds moist through misters, you know, during the summertime specifically. So yeah, it's super important, guys, if you guys are adding live worm castings to your garden or even just care about your soil biology in your garden, you want to minimally have some kind of hose end filter to filter your water. The one I recommend is the Boogie Blue water filter, linked down below to the video where I made about the Boogie Blue. That's the one designed for gardening. That being said, if you guys want to be cheap, which is fine, sometimes I'm cheap, sometimes I'm not, on watering filtering, I wouldn't be cheap, but some of you guys don't want to spend the money on the Boogie Blue, you could get just a really good high-end RV filter. Because it's not made for gardening, you may need to change it out more often than not because it's not meant for high volume use. But yeah, that's another way. Even Walmart sells inexpensive RV filters, which will definitely make your garden better. I mean, hopefully you guys aren't drinking like unfiltered water. We don't want to feed our plants unfiltered water either, especially if it's municipal and has been treated with chlorine, for example, that is in there to kill the bacteria. So I think, speaking about bacteria, I want to show you guys actually why these worm castings are superior than bag products you'd be able to buy in town, because it actually has biology and it's verified biology. The farm owner has actually gone through Elaine Ingham's course, the Food Soil Web course, and you know, when he told me that, like, to me that means a lot, because most worm farmers don't go through that course. They're just trying to produce, you know, castings out of food waste. But this farmer really cares about the castings and really wants to do the best he can to bring the best biology in your garden so you could grow more food, and also he could take a chunk out of the landfill waste and divert it. So this is what really sets this worm farm apart, is that they have a microscope here, high-end microscope, that then they basically take samples of their castings, which is actually right here. They make slides of it, and then they could actually look at the biological activity and soon enough do actually a food soil web analysis on castings you bring them, or even your own soil or compost you make, so you guys can know what's in there to basically dial in your setup. Not many people have this certification, so I'm glad we'll have somebody in Vegas that can do that for you. But meanwhile, what he's been doing is he has been checking out his castings to make sure they are alive and full of life, right? There can be active bacteria and active fungi and active food soil web creatures, but then sometimes those creatures, if the conditions aren't right, like if they're put in a bag, they can't breathe, they're shipped long distances, they could basically go into a cyst or spore form where they're kind of like in like hibernation, and if the conditions are right, they may wake up, or they may never wake up if the conditions aren't right, right? So that's what he's checking out here on the screen. And if you guys can see on the screen, we have a micro arthropod right here, right? We have a bacteria eating nematode right there. I think over here somewhere, we had a naked amoeba down here, right? These are all good creatures to have in your soil, because what they do is when you have living soil, you have all these creatures in the soil. They're eating bacteria, eating fungi. They're pooping out basically nutrients. The plants send exudates or sugars down to the roots that then some of these creatures will feed on, and then these creatures will break down and solubilize minerals in your soil, solubilize organic matter, and send proteins and amino acids up to your plants so that your plants could grow and thrive, right? This is what's not happening when you sprinkle miracle grow or fertilizers, you know, synthetic fertilizers on your garden. Your plants could take those nutrients up directly, surpassing the food soil web, and in my opinion, creating a very low vibrancy, low nutrition food because you're not utilizing nature. So I think also there's some cysts in here, and there's some spores in here as well that are dormant that may wake up. Now here's the thing, right? The thing is this, when you guys buy a bag soil, right, it's not gonna have the live creatures in there. It's gonna have mostly spore-based, and it also depends on how old it is, and that's why the goal at this worm farm is to basically, when you order it, he'll harvest it to order, and then he'll take it right to you and deliver it sometimes the same day or maybe even the next day, so you're getting the livest creatures that then you don't want it to sit around in your house for a week, right? You want to immediately take it out, mix it into your garden beds, generate compost tea with it, you know, put it into your starting, soil blends to do transplants. You want to use that stuff as quickly as possible so you could maximize the beneficial microbes, inside the live worm castings they're producing here. The very important thing is that, you know, they're using all local ingredients, and they basically create a lot of local indigenous microbes, right? So, you know, if you're living in Las Vegas, you know, it's not the best thing in the world to buy worm castings made in New York. They have entirely different climatic conditions. The bacteria and different, you know, creatures, food soil web creatures in the worm castings from New York may not like the Las Vegas weather, right? If you're getting Las Vegas worm castings, you're knowing that, hey, these creatures in the worm castings love the weather and conditions here in Vegas and they could thrive, right? So that's very important distinction. So I encourage you guys always to try to source locally made worm castings no matter where you live. And of course, if you don't have a nice worm farm like Las Vegas Worm Farm here, go out and make your own worm castings. You guys saw the setup and how he does it here. Growing some worms is not rocket science, guys. Have some worms, keep them at the right temperature, keep them the right hydration level, and feed them the good foods. Break down the food scraps and the compost, and you're gonna make your own local castings, which is always best. Anyways, last thing I wanna do is we're gonna go ahead and interview the worm farmer to learn more about why he started Las Vegas Worm Farm, learn more about the food cell web, and even how you can buy some of his castings or worms if you live locally. All right, so now I have the pleasure of interviewing for you guys Dennis, the owner and farmer here at Las Vegas Worm Farm. We're gonna learn why he started a worm farm in his garage, and actually this is not even his first job. His first job is he is in the military. He's a serviceman, so I thank you, Dennis, for your service. Highly respect on that, and then even just, he gets home at midnight and he's feeding his worms at 2 a.m., dude. This guy is dedicated, I'm gonna tell you guys that. Like, I would not go through all this, but each one of his worms is like his pets. I mean, they have a bunch of dogs here, which are pets, and they take care, but he takes care of his worms, and I've seen the utmost care in his worms, care that a lot of worm farms I've visited in the past have not taken. When he was showing me the worm factory, there's worms on the top, and he cares for them so much that he's taking them off the top, putting them back into the soil so that they're not just, walking on the plastic or whatever, they're crawling on the plastic. And I've seen worm farms that I go to and they're just shoving worms apart. They drop on the ground and then they'll just step on them. I'm like, oh man, they're babies, man. Like, we need to take care and appreciate other creatures on the planet. So I want to see what we could learn from Dennis today about Las Vegas worms enriching your garden, and more importantly, why he started the farm here. So Dennis, to start off, is why did you start a worm farm in your garage after, this is not even your first job? You're like in the military, which I'm sure takes a lot of time, effort, and energy. And also you have, pets, kids, and a garden, and a lawn to take care of here in Vegas. You're so busy. Why add on the worms?
Because it was beneficial. That's why. I saw that there was something happening in my wife's garden during COVID. She had a very big garden, and we went to move it, and there were a lot of worms in it. And I wanted to know why. And she couldn't really answer that question. She was like, they're beneficial. And that wasn't really good enough for me. So I did a little bit of research, and after that, I bought my first pound of worms. And then I got curious, and I said, oh, wow, look, these worms, I can feed them. Why are they so important? So I got into a little bit of the soil biology, and then I was like, maybe I can make these guys reproduce. So I started reproducing them, and then one thing led to another, more and more things, and then the next thing I know is I'm trying to take local waste and recycle it, and I'm using the worms to be able to do that, to be able to provide people with something that is a living soil that they can actually use and benefit from in the garden.
Wow, that's amazing. So why is one of your main primary goals is to basically utilize local waste that would otherwise go to the landfill, right? Why is that so important to you, so that you won't even import inputs or use inputs to make your worms even better, but to use only local ingredients? Because to me, I respect that highly.
Yeah, so that's a really good question. So the importance of the local ingredients is because when you get stuff from outside, it's kind of like introducing something non-native, right? So there's some plants that we can't get from California or New Mexico or even Mexico or Canada. We're just not allowed to import those things. And there's reasons for that, right? There's pests associated with it, or maybe they'll take over the entire ecosystem. So I like to use what is here and what is local because it's already here. Plus, it already survives here, right? So if it can maintain these conditions and live here, then let's use what we already have. Let's not bring in what we need, what we have, what we don't need from the outside.
And then why is it so important to divert, waste and products that would normally go to the landfill, like the cardboard, like the food scraps, or even like the yards, scaping waste material that you bring into this compost that's locally produced?
Yeah, so everybody knows that the landfill is a bad place, right?
Yep.
It produces a lot of methane, which is terrible for the ozone, right? It, there's a bunch of other reasons that these things should not go to the landfill. I grew up in Germany where my grandparents, they still recycle to this day. They have a compost bin and they put all of their recyclables in there, their papers, all that material. So that's kind of how I grew up, and I was like, you know, there's probably a better way to do this instead of putting everything into the trash and then sending it to the landfill where, you know, I can leave the place better for my kids and their kids and their kids.
Yeah, I mean, same thing. I grew up in California. They've been having green bins there where you could recycle your landscape waste and food scraps for 20 plus years now, and Vegas still does not have any green bins. It all goes to the landfill, and there's only one person on the earth that really loves when that happens. It's the garbage company, because they're getting rich, and I hate the stupid garbage company because they create laws that make it harder for people to divert things to go to landfill, because when it goes to landfill, they get paid, and when it gets diverted and gets recycled or gets composted, right, they're losing money because that's money they're not making, and it just bothers me so much that, you know, things like composting and recycling and diverting waste or even reusing it, right, is just really not happening here, unfortunately, due to politics and big business. All right, Dennis, so learning more about, you know, diverting the waste, let's talk about the indigenous microbes and food soil web creatures in this area that are also very important, why you only sell your products locally here. And I mean, as good as this stuff is, and as I showed you guys, he's not going to ship this to you guys even to Utah or Arizona. He's only going to actually deliver it fresh locally. You know, why are you so strong on these beliefs?
Just because I don't want to step outside of my community. I want to serve the people that are here. I want to use the waste streams that we have here to be able to service the community, right? So, and by doing so, I'm building the local soils as well, right? When I try to take things from outside or bring them, you know, here or send them other places, it's not being utilized here. So let's use what we have here and create something that we can all benefit from, right? So, and that's important when you get down to the microbes and stuff, right? Because the bacteria that live here for a reason, right? And the fungi that lives here for the reason. The protozoas, nematodes, microarthropods, all those guys, they live here and they chose this place for a reason because they can survive here. So if I can get those guys and multiply those guys and then put those guys in the garden where they can do the good work and create a living soil and help everybody out, right, in our gardens, why not do that, right? I don't want to grab something from Utah, California, New Mexico, and I don't want to send my stuff there because it might not work, right? Those guys might be living when they get there, but when they go into the soil, they might turn into a cyst, right? They might turn into a little incubated cell that isn't going to do anything for you. So that's one of those things that I want to serve the community with the things I have here because I think it's most beneficial for us locally.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree that in an ideal world, you should have a local source of worm castings or even make your own. Or even start your own worm casting company like Dennis has here in his garage. You can start your own worm casting company in every city in the country, you know, in Utah and Arizona and New Mexico, Texas, wherever you are, and serve your local community. Once again, doing some amazing work, diverting waste that would otherwise go to the landfill, and also more importantly, serving your local community with all the different food soil web creatures that are going to thrive in your specific environment. And also, of course, reduce the carbon emissions from shipping, you know, a lot of these products all over the country. Of course, if you guys, you know, I always encourage you guys to have your own worm bin or even just put worms in your garden, dig a hole and put worms in there and then bury your food scraps in there. The worms will eat them. I mean, worms are not particular, you know, I mean, he keeps them inside, so he has to do a lot more work inside than he has to do outside to keep them alive. So, Dennis, what do you do to keep all your worms alive inside, especially during the middle of the summer, where I know it's going to get at least 100 degrees here in your garage because it's not air conditioned?
That is very difficult. So my garage also faces south, which, as you know, gets all of the sunlight all of the time. So it gets over 100 degrees in here. I do have an exhaust fan in the ceiling that helps me exhaust some of that hot temperatures. But in addition to that, I also keep these bins, these large bins, on misters, right? So keeping a fine mist, not dousing it, right? It allows that airflow to come across and do kind of what a swamp cooler would do, right? So it creates that feeling of something cool. So the worms will come up to the surface where they usually are anyway, but they'll stay there and they can cool off a little bit So it keeps my bins right around 80-ish degrees, you know, plus or minus depending on what the temperatures are. But I also try to insulate the garage doors to help out with that heat temperature as well. And it is very difficult trying to keep them alive during the summertime in the garage. I would highly recommend, and I always do to anybody out there, right? If you've ever met me, I always tell you, put your worms in your garden.
Yep.
Get a bucket, put some holes in it, cut the bottom out, put it in your garden, put a lid on it, and just feed it that way. You don't have to sift the worms. You don't have to sift the castings. It's already in your garden, ready to go. It's so much easier, so much simpler, and you don't have to deal with all of this.
Yeah, and you don't have to be an expert. Like, you know, he's an expert taking care of worms, making sure the temperature's right, the humidity's right, all these things. Like, put them out in the garden, and they do all the work for you because they'll figure out. If it's too hot, they'll burrow down deeper. If it's not, but inside, they can't do all these things. They could go out and find water and stuff if they need to, if they're in your garden, but they're not going to do that indoors. So, yeah, I concur, man. Like, keep worms outside. That's where they belong, unless you're, you know, really good and can deal with them, keeping them alive inside. So, Dennis, I know you have some outside worm bins, right? So how do you keep those alive, you know, in the summertime, in the summer heat? Like, what do you do special out there?
So the outbuilder bins are different, right? And they are special. If you're going to have them above ground the way I do, the bigger, the better, right? Thermal mass. It takes longer for something larger to heat up or cool down than something small. So I would highly recommend that if you are going to keep them outside, the bigger your container is, the better. The container I have outside is 2 feet by 8 feet long. It's also 2 feet deep. The other container I have is 3 feet wide by 2 feet long and 3 feet deep. So these are pretty large containers. And because of that, they are able to maintain temperatures and they stay outside. My large bin, the smaller bin stays covered all year round because I feed it fresh food, as you saw. I don't want critters and stuff coming in there, so that stays covered. The other bin stays open until the 100 degree weather, and then I cover it. Additionally, an important key point is that they need moisture, so in the summertime they get watered every day, and then when the temperatures get too hot, the big bin does get covered. Why do I do that? Is because it needs shade. My bins are on the east side of the house. They get maybe 4 hours of sunshine. After that, it is completely dark. Or not dark, it's shaded, right? But the shade portion is huge, right? So if you go any smaller, what you're going to run into is issues with a lot of heating, right? And there's ways to mitigate that. But mass is your friend if you're going to be worm farming above ground.
Cool. But yeah, once again, the easiest way is just put worms in your garden under the soil where they belong. So, you know, Dennis, I know there's a lot of different kinds of composting worms, but why did you choose the specific worms that you're growing here in Vegas? I mean, do they survive better in Vegas than other kinds of composting worms, for example?
Yeah, of course, yeah. So there's about 7 different kinds of composting worms in the United States, or North America, let's put it that way, all across the country. The reason I chose the red wiggler is because after doing research, they're the most temperature tolerant. They're the easiest, laid back. They just go with the flow kind of worm, right? They're not really particular, right? There's other types of worms like the Indian blue worm. They're a tropical worm, so they're going to be a little more apt to like the warmer weather, right? A little more moisture. But as soon as it gets cold, those guys don't really like it, right? The African night crawlers, they love hot weather as well, right? In the name, African night crawlers, so nice hot worm. Our temperatures are 100 degrees, you know, 90 degrees. Those guys love it. They thrive. But as soon as it gets colder, those guys are going to die off, right? And you're going to lose those guys. European night crawlers, they like European temperatures, right? Nice, moderate temperatures. They probably do really well in California. But unfortunately out here, when the summertime comes around, those guys die. So I chose the red wiggler because they are the easiest, the most temperature tolerant. And they keep well here. I keep them outside. I keep them indoors. And they do perfectly fine.
Yeah, actually, I've only shown 2 places you have worms in your garden. Indoors, in the bins outside, but I actually didn't show his garden, where he also has lots of worms in there as well. So getting back to your garden and your wife's garden, which I saw, which is amazing this time of year, because you got it all basically kind of getting ready for the springtime. What benefits has your wife seen from using the worm castings? And more importantly, what customer feedback have you gotten from people that you've sold your castings to that use it in their gardens? Like, what have they seen by using your worm castings? Like, what differences have happened?
So specifically, I've had customers come in and say that their trees or their plants are struggling during the summertime. Mm. And into the fall, they're usually trying to figure things out to how do I get these guys going. And usually starting the solution earlier rather than later is always the best option, but sometimes that's not possible, right? Like, I don't always pay attention to what's going on in the backyard, and then all of a sudden it doesn't look so good. So we have to take action. And those actions are usually adding the worm castings or some type of organic material, compost, right, into the soil. And then after a while, you see the effects, right? The plant starts to perk back up, especially if you're using some type of tea. If you're brewing tea, I know you brew tea. If you put those effects are quite rapid, and you can see the repair in the plant quickly over a short period of time. So that's the what I've heard from my customers. What we see here is my wife is a plant killer. So all of our indoor plants are hers. And usually what happens is when they're on their last leg and they're looking rough, she will come into the garage, grab a handful of worm castings, sprinkle it.
She doesn't pay you for it?
No. I do not take money from her.
She probably takes money from you.
Sometimes. But she'll take those worm castings, she'll sprinkle it into her plants indoors, and within a few days after watering, they perk right back up. And the same thing with the backyard, right? Last year she complimented on the flowers, like how pretty the blooms were and like how colorful and how long they actually lasted, right? Mm. And she was like, wow, I didn't know that, you know, like those wildflowers would last so long, or like they keep popping up, right? And it's because the soil has been amended, and it's able for those seeds and those plants to thrive longer because all the nutrients there is continually cycling, right? It's a food web. Like, as long as you have a healthy soil and the organisms are there, like, it will keep replenishing itself with minimal effort, because I am a lazy gardener, and I will broadcast seeds, and I will throw in compost twice a year, some castings and some worm tea when I get around to brewing it. But besides that, I'm not very particular or like detailed.
Me, on the other hand, I'm super detailed about my garden, but I wouldn't be so particular about my worms, because I'm just not. So we balance each other out. All right, so Dennis, I want to ask you, like, why do you think the worm castings actually work and help people to make their garden even better? I know, you know, some people may claim fertilizer values on worm castings, and to me, that's not really the value. What say you?
So, yeah, I'm definitely in. Numbers mean something, right, and to some people. So when you're looking at numbers on bags, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, all that, right, that is nutrients that are in the soil at that point in time. But once that gets used up, it's gone. You got to go buy more, right? Like, that's it. Lifetime is ended. Like, now I got to go spend more money to put more stuff into my soil. And I was like, that's not a good way to do business, right? That's not how Mother Nature does it, right? Mother Nature does it on her own. And she has all these things, right? When I grew up in Germany, there's walking path and there's trees, and there would be wild strawberries, raspberries, all on the side of the walking path, right? Underneath these trees. Nobody put it there. Mother Nature just did it all on her own, right? So that is the benefit of having worms, and what they produce is in their poop, right? There's a test done out there. I'm sure it's on my website somewhere or on my social media. And it shows a chart, and it has the amount of bacteria that comes out of the back of a worm. And then it shows also the amount of bacteria that is made in bokashi, traditional composting, thermophilic, or a regular compost pile, a thermophilic compost pile, and the numbers are off the charts. The biodiversity that's in worm casting poo is off the charts. There's nothing out there that I've seen so far that has the amount of life in it that worm poop does. And all that does is it feeds the soil, right? And it just creates this poop loop that feeds itself. And in the end, if it creates all this potassium, nitrogen, magnesium, zinc that your plant needs, your plant continues feeding the soil, and the soil continues feeding your plant. It's a continuous process, and you never have to really touch it. So that's what I like about it. And that's what I think worm castings bring to the table when you're talking about growing plants and trying to be as close to Mother Nature as possible.
Cool. So, I mean, I understood that, and I want to get it broken down a little bit more for you guys out there that don't understand it. Like, basically saying that if you guys buy, like, fertilizer, like Miracle-Gro, right, 10, 10, 10, or whatever, you put it on there, it gets used up, it leaches out, it'll actually probably pollute in the, you know, Gulf of Mexico and all these things, causing dead zones, which is what most commercial farmers actually do. and then it's gone. And then like, oh, now I need to buy more to feed my plant again because it's going to wash out and be gone. Meanwhile, if you add worm castings, like, where do the nutrients come from the worm castings? There's like hardly any nutrients in there, but what there is there's biology in there. The biology, right, the bacteria, the fungi, the arthropods, the mini arthropods, all the different creatures in there basically will find things in the soil, right, minerals, organic matter, eat those things, and then they actually poop out nitrogen, they poop out phosphorus, you know, they'll make minerals more available to your plant. So you want to elaborate on this a bit more since you've gone through the food soil web program and I haven't.
Yeah, so it's a poop loop, right? So it's basically a predator-prey concept where if you put enough prey into an area, right? Like if you have, let's call bacteria sheep. There's a bunch of sheep there, right? And all of a sudden, one wolf comes around and it eats that sheep and then it poops. Well, that poop is now nutrients to something, right? And in this case, we'll say it's nutrients to the plants, right? So now you have one sheep, one wolf. Well, that wolf is going to reproduce, right? And because it's eating and it's happy, now you have two wolves and three wolves. And now all of a sudden, these sheep are also multiplying and you have more predators. Well, these predators keep eating these prey and they keep pooping out nutrients that are plant-soluble nutrients, right? It's nutrients that are readily available for your plant, right? And the plants can take that stuff up right away, right? And then that's kind of how that portion of it works. And the plant, of course, has its roots, right? And it does its parts with pushing exudates, sugars, into the soil and then attracting these bacteria, these sheep, and then it's just a continuous predator-prey kind of cycle. So once these predators poop, they poop out the nitrogen, magnesium, phosphate, phosphorus, they poop out all of these things that your plants need to grow, right? And what's funny about how the actual soil food web kind of works is that the plant only pushes out the type of exudates that it needs for specific bacteria that produce what the plant needs. So if the plant needs phosphorus, it pushes out exudates to attract that bacteria and those predators to be able to poop out that nitrogen, right? So it's a nice little loop. The plant has a lot of influence on what the soil does, and that's why I do the chop and drop method, right? Keep the roots alive in the soil because they're still feeding the soil and the soil then feeds the plant. I hope that kind of breaks that down.
Yeah, I mean, I hope you guys understood that. He broke it down a bit differently. But I mean, here's the thing, guys. I mean, even organic gardeners will tell you to, you could buy the organic fertilizer, the 5-8-8, you know, or something. The numbers are a lot lower. But once again, you know, those are all, you know, fertilizer numbers that, you know, will run out a lot slower because hopefully it's not in all soluble materials. But really the goal is to build up your bacteria and food soil web creatures, right? And then just keep adding compost and things to feed them, including have live roots in the soil, right? That'll actually feed the creatures too and keep them alive. And then you can make your own fertilizer and get out of the whole stupid, you know, I gotta feed this fertilizer game, right? And you're not gonna hear this message on a lot of organic channels, unfortunately. And that's why I'm here today to share with you guys the importance of the worm castings, right? Worm castings are one of my top ingredients that I add to every single garden bed when I make it, and also every season when I top off. In addition, I use the worm castings to produce the compost tea, which is how I would actually use the Las Vegas worm farm castings, because, you know, he has limited quantities. You can't just like add a ton of it to your soil like I would encourage you guys to do with, you know, store-bought castings where you could buy a lot bigger bags for, you know, less money. So Dennis, let's talk about how you can actually multiply the microbes and even get more benefits from the castings that you're growing here by creating a very simple, compost tea.
Right. So the way we do it here, right, and what works for us here is we use a 5-gallon bucket. We have an air pump. We have a specific aerator that we put in there as well that you can buy off of Amazon pretty cheaply. And then you have a mesh bag. I think it's a 400 mesh bag that it's required. It allows the microbes to kind of go out. And what we'll do is we'll put compost castings into the bag, right? And then we'll also feed the microbes at that point. So depending on what we want to grow, do we want to grow bacteria? Do we want to grow protozoas, right? Do we want to grow fungi? Fungi is a little difficult to grow in a tea, but we add specific foods for those guys, right? So bacteria like simple sugars, so we'll add in, you know, simple sugars into that. If we want more protozoas, then we'll add a little more complex foods, right? So maybe some grass or alfalfa, stuff like that. Stuff that I can go grab in the backyard, really. I'm not trying to buy anything, right? But if I can get it from the backyard, then I'll throw it in the bag, some leaves, stuff like that. And then we'll brew it, right? So brewing should always be done at whatever the outside temperature is, right? You don't never really want to do it inside and then take your product outside. So if the temperature is 50 degrees outside, then brew it outside. Based upon the temperature range, right, that's how long you should recommended time for you to brew. Here, I run my stuff through a microscope, right? So every few hours, 4 to 6 hours is ideal. Sometimes I can only run another microscope every 12 hours, depends on how busy I am. But I'll run another microscope and actually see what's going on. Am I growing the good guys? Am I growing the bad guys? Do I need to add more food? Did I add too much food and now I have too much bacteria, right? And I need more protozoas? This is all things that I kind of check underneath the microscope. But what you can do at home is kind of just, you know, take the castings and take compost, put it in a bag, add an aerator to it, you know, make sure, of course, though, you don't want any chlorinated water. So make sure your water is either a well water or filtered out somehow.
Or rainwater.
Yeah, rainwater is great. That stuff is amazing.
That's the best.
Yeah. Plants grow great after a rain. Or bottled water or something like that. Put it in a 5-gallon bucket and then just brew it. Recommended is like 24 hours. That should get you right in about the area. The problem a lot of people can run into is if you brew too long, you could start breeding anaerobic bacteria, which is bad. And when you pour that onto your garden or anywhere that you want, you know, like to grow, you could be doing the opposite. So I'd say stick with 24 hours and you'll probably be safe. Any longer than that, you might be running into some issues. There is also, you need a lot of air. A lot of air, especially if you're adding in food, because those microbes, they're just like us, right? They like to eat and they like to breathe. So the more food we have, the more we breathe, right? So we need both they need oxygen and food. So that is really important. So
cool. So I mean, hopefully you guys learned more about the importance of the earthworm castings. Now I'm gonna get a little more technical with Dennis about some of the equipment that he's actually constructed and made himself to do some of these specific projects. So like, the thing I like the most of all of his equipment is actually, of course, the hammer mill. So, Dennis, you want to talk about why did you finally end up having to import your own hammer mill and how beneficial is that to your worm farm?
So, like a lot of worm farmers, we try to figure out what we can do on a budget, right? So, this is my second year in business, so there's not a lot of money coming in. So, everything's on a budget. We started out with a shredder. I've got multiple shredders.
Oh, you got shredders. I didn't see them. Yeah,
I actually cut the shredders off the top, and I used to put food down in there. Shred my food.
And how did that work? Did it like mess it up or anything?
No, it works.
Oh, really?
It's just very slow. So it works if on a small scale, right? So if you're doing it at home, you could shred all that stuff in the shredder. Just cut the top off, right? And you could put your food scraps in there, and it'll shred it up, right? The more pore spaces you have, the more microbes you can breed, right? So I like small particle sizes. Not too small, right? I need oxygen airflow too. But so I started out with a shredder. That worked great for a little while until I started growing and started getting busy, bigger. And then we got into a commercial grade blender. The commercial grade blender worked okay for a little while. I wouldn't say it was the best piece of equipment, but it worked okay. And then I was trying to figure out, okay, I need something else. Because at this point, I was using a shredder for food. I was using a shredder for cardboard. Now I was using a blender. And I was trying to find a multi-tool piece of equipment that I could use for multiple things at once. And that kind of led me down to the hammer mill route, right? The problem is I couldn't find one locally. Most of the pieces that I did find were massive commercial grade pieces that cost $20,000, $30,000, $50,000, $80,000. And that's just not something that is feasible. So I actually looked into trying to make one. And that seemed dangerous, so I was like, let's not do that. So I, of course, went overseas, right? I used Alibaba. I went online and I ordered something, and it was kind of a crapshoot.
You don't know if you're gonna even get it. Number one, they're gonna rip you off, take your money, or if it's even gonna work good.
Yeah. So, and that was a huge learning curve, right? Because I was like, okay, I'll just order it, and it'll just come to my house. No, it doesn't come to your house. It goes to a warehouse, right? And that warehouse isn't necessarily here locally, so. At the end of the day, I thought I paid for an $800 piece of equipment, and it ended up probably being around $1,500.
Wow, almost twice as much.
Twice as much after getting it to the port, getting, taxed. import costs, shipping costs from that port to the next port.
The holding for like keeping it in storage at some stupid place for a while.
Yep. So there's a bunch of fees and everything else that was associated with that. Good learning experience, right? Like now I can say I can import stuff from China or India probably. But it was a huge learning curve. But I am extremely happy with the piece of equipment that I have, right? It does run on 220, so if you don't have
220.
Yeah, if you don't have 220, it's not gonna work. But it's great, and it's allowed me to process cardboard, it allows me to process food. I can run wood chips through it, although it deteriorates my hammers on it pretty quickly, so I don't really like to do that. But you can run stones through it, right? They use hammer mills for stones.
Oh yeah, rock dust making.
Rock dust making and stuff like that. So and then I like the ability, its flexibility of being very coarse and very fine. So I like running my material that I source from the neighborhood, right? So my mesquite seeds, my leaves and stuff like that for my worm chow, I like running that stuff through the hammer mill. It does a fantastic job. Very good job at processing that stuff. The food stuff was a little tinkering. I always have to figure out what I can and can't do, right? Some of the stringy stuff like bananas.
I get stuck.
Yeah, the fibers are kind of long and it doesn't really do a good job of chopping that stuff up. So I have to be careful on what I actually throw in there. The blender is actually really good for that. But I don't think I've used the blender in quite a long time.
All right, cool. And let's finally talk about the trommel. So the trommel you made is totally amazing. I mean, how much did it actually cost you to make? I showed it on the video and showed how cool it is. I think it's really cool, man. I wish I had one.
Yeah, so the trommel, that was something that I definitely needed. The screens, that's a lot of work. That's a lot of work. So the trommel saved me a lot of heartache and back pains and everything else. The trommel altogether probably ran me around $350.
Wow.
Let's call it maybe $400. And if anybody is looking at a trommel or has ever looked at a trommel, for something that size with a single screen, you're probably close to $5,000 after it comes to your house. So they're quite expensive. They're quite large pieces. I like the ability that I had the ability to scale this one down, so I made it to exactly what I thought I would need. And I have two screens in it, and the treadmill motor works fantastic. Like, I have the ability to change the speeds for whatever I want. So if I'm doing compost, I can turn it up and it'll go real fast and I can process stuff. But for the worms, which I have not ran through and I probably won't just because I don't want to hurt those guys, I would turn it down really, really low. Mm. Yeah. So we're looking at probably like somewhere between 7 and 11 revolutions per minute.
Wow, super worms, slow.
It is quite slow.
They don't want to damage them.
Yeah, it is quite slow. But yeah, right around $350, $400, so over a $5,000 piece of equipment. If you're kind of handy, there's a bunch of YouTube videos out there on how to make a trommel. I just kind of tinkered and kind of put it all together. I didn't really follow any type of plan. I just took little pieces of this, little piece of this, kind of just like the worm farm, right? Like, everybody's got a good idea on that. Kind of take those, tinker, put it together, and that's what we have today. We have a trommel that's run by a treadmill.
That's awesome. All right, Dennis, so one of the last questions I have for you is, if somebody lives locally and they want to get your worm castings, right, how can they do that?
Yeah, so I have a website. You can go to LasVegasWormFarm.com. You can also reach out to me on Facebook and Instagram, any one of those. I will respond back to you. I do have a normal 9-to-5 job, but I am in the military and I do have a regular job. So I will get back to your messages and I will answer your questions as soon as I can. Just be patient with me. It's usually within a few hours unless I'm at work, and then it's probably like 6 hours, but it won't be more than a day before I can answer your questions. Yeah, just go to the website. I've got the worms and worm castings on there, and they are pretty much sifted to order. So if you want castings, I kind of sift those when you order it. Same thing with worms. I need about 24 hours notice because I pull them out and then I give them to you. That way it's not sitting around drying out and you're losing some of that life that you need in your garden.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really cool thing. I've never seen a worm farm that really harvests to order. Every place always bags stuff up, which is honestly not ideal, but of course it makes it a lot easier work. The way Dennis is doing is a lot more work. He's a lot more busy. So Dennis, if somebody has questions about maybe starting a worm farm like this in their city, or questions about worms, the castings or worms you have here, are you open to taking questions, and how can they contact you?
Yeah, if anybody wants to contact me, I'm on social media, Facebook and Instagram. Use the messenger, shoot me a message. You can contact me through there. You can contact me through the website as well. There's a, I think, a ask me or contact me thing there. Yeah, if you want to reach out to me, you can reach out to me at any point in time. I will answer all your questions. If you have worm questions, if you have soil questions, if you have soil biology questions, I'll do my best to answer all of your questions to the best of my ability. If I don't have the answer, I will get back to you in a period of time after I do some research to figure out what you're actually looking for and how to best help you. If you're trying to start your own worm farm, I recommend don't do it. It's a lot of work, unless you have a lot of free time and you're very young, because it's very labor intensive. I think Zach down at Arizona Worm Farm will probably tell you the exact same thing. It is a ton of work. It is backbreaking work. It is very tedious when it comes to moisture control, how much to feed them, how much not to feed them. But it's very fun. I enjoy it, and that's why I do it. And if anybody wants to learn how to do it, I'd be more than happy to tell you how I do it here and what works for us.
Wow. So, I mean, this guy is completely amazing. So, Dennis, I got to ask you, what keeps you motivated to help others, to learn about worms, to educate people about worms, to divert food waste? Like, why do you do all this stuff when you have a regular, you know, well, military job, not 9 to 5 because it's some weird hours, but why do you do all this stuff, man, in addition to, like, taking care of your family, your wife, and your kids, and other animals, you know, at the house here?
So, one thing is I'm coming up on retirement, so I'm close to being finished with the military. I've served my country for 19 years now, so I got 1 year left, and then I'll be finished with that portion of my life. Really, the reason I started a business is this business was for my family, right? Hopefully being a business owner allows me to have more time with my family and my kids, spend more time with them, right? If I have to go to a normal job, it doesn't afford me the opportunity to kind of spend that time with them. So if I can be at home more with these guys, then that's really what I want to do. And that's kind of why I started the business. The other side of the house, the reason I started the business is because I did grow up in Germany, and I told you about my grandparents, and they were very big on gardening and composting, and that was just how Germany was, and it still is today. And I was like, there's got to be a way that we can do that here, right? So if I can do it here and help out the community, then that's what I want to do. So those are like the two reasons that I started this endeavor, even though it is very long hours and a lot of work. I still enjoy it, though.
Wow, my hat's off to you, man. I definitely agree that we need worm casting and diverting food waste here in Las Vegas more than most places because, you know, in my opinion, moving from California to here, it's so backwards here. So I'm so glad that you figured out how to do it properly and you could help educate people at their home, you know, to do it as well, to divert food waste and also, more importantly, bring back the indigenous microorganisms, create more food soil web gardens, and spread this knowledge to others, you know, by answering all the questions and taking all the time it takes to do that, because I don't even do that because I'm so busy. So, Dennis, any last words of wisdom you'd love to share with my viewers before we sign off today?
If you're looking at doing worms, just jump in. Don't be scared. The easiest way is just to put them outside in your garden. Dr. Clive Edwards from, I believe, Ohio State said that a healthy soil has somewhere between 100 and 250 worms. So that's not a lot, right? But it's probably more than what you have in your garden right now. So best thing to do is just get a bucket, put it in your garden, throw some worms in it, and have a good time. You'll see your plants and flowers and trees flourish from it, and even your yards if some of you have lawns. And then if you want to reach out to me for any questions, any concerns, if you want to come out, if you would like me to come speak for any type of topics, I can cover compost, worms, maybe a little bit of soil biology. I'll be more than happy to do that. Just reach out to me on social media or my website.
Wonderful. I'll put all his links down below so that you can contact him. All right, Dennis, so thanks for having me out today and being able to spread the message of worms, worm farming, the benefits of casting, and how you're diverting food waste here and other materials from going to the landfill. I really enjoyed my time here, and I hope you guys out there in YouTube land also enjoyed it. Whether you live here locally in Vegas or whether you live in some far-off lands, I mean, the power of the worms are essential for gardeners, and this man is helping the world to, you know, become more educated and learn about it, because unfortunately it's not talked about often enough. If you guys enjoy this episode, want me to come back and visit Dennis in future episodes, hey, please be sure to give this a big thumbs up. More importantly, share this with other people that garden around the world, but especially if they live here in the Las Vegas Valley, so that they could be aware of some of the best place in the valley to get the worms
and the worm castings to get them in your garden bed. The one thing I will say is after moving from California, where basically worms show up naturally, moving here to Vegas and like having zero worms in my garden, actually having to bring them in and then treat them right so they actually multiply was one of the best things I ever did. So if you live here, you definitely want to, you know, connect with Dennis and get you started on getting your first bucket of worms, setting up a system so that you can keep them alive in your garden, because it will make your garden even better. And that may be one of the reasons why you failed here growing in the desert. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you never miss out my new and upcoming episodes. I'll come in every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I show up, what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And make sure you click the little bell to get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,700 episodes at this time on this channel dedicated to teach you guys all about how to grow your own food at home using some of the best practices out there. Links down below to some of the videos I made at other worm farms in Texas and Arizona and even California so that you can see how they all work, because they all work a little bit different and everybody has their own system that works for them. And if you're considering making your own worm farm, then it says don't. But if you are, you know, look at all the different concepts and kind of take what's going to work for your specific area. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.